Ja si myslím, že sme na správnom mieste. Čiže museli niekde túto do tohoto sváhnu.
Dobre, tak môžeme skúšiť
tam. Tam by mohlo byť to miesto dopadu.
These men are aviation cadets. A short while ago, they too were average American boys.
We were all a bunch of happy
American
kids,
family.
Even a pilot. They sent a bunch of kids up there to fight a war.
I don't think people know how much war is a business of children. Most of the people who fight in wars are not really adults.
As big and bulky as I am, have plenty of loose weight, they put me in the smallest space in the airplane, the ball turret. So I was happy, and the Air Corps was happy, until Hitler's little henchmen got the best of us.
I think we young men were reacting to the fact that so many people were being mistreated, being persecuted, murdered. And there seemed to be nobody to, or not enough people to stop them.
During World War II, the 15th U.S. Air Force carried out raids on strategic German targets from their bases in Italy, with the aim of paralyzing enemy infrastructure and attacking communications, roads, and supply lines in occupied Europe. Up till then, Slovakia had been spared from the majority of wartime violence, but this was no longer true.
The first mission that I flew on to Ploesti, to the oil field. Our leader, he blew up. Boom. It took the anti-aircraft right into the airplane and it exploded in the airplane. See the bodies of the crew, the bodies that fly by. There were bodies falling. Well, 54 airplanes, 10 men on each airplane. That's 500 men that were getting blown out of their airplane.
I never thought of being shot down. Never. I saw many people bailing out or jumping out of the airplane, but I never thought of that happening to me.
Most airmen were 19 to 20 years old on average. Many enlisted in the Army Air Corps immediately after finishing high school. They were boys rather than men, thrust into the whirlwind of war, and they had to mature quickly. Chances of completing the number of required missions and returning alive and well were only 1 in 5. They saw their buddies being shot down daily and had to pull themselves together quickly and carry on with their missions.
I was in my turret, been shooting the airplane. And our plane was on fire, and our pilot called us to bail out. I didn't think about anything else but getting out of the plane. I finally landed in a wheat field and I could hear a dog barking, and two farmers came up to us. We didn't know where we were. We got out our maps. We carried silk maps, and they showed us we were Slovakia. Slovakia, I said, I don't even know where Slovakia is.
The first American warplanes were shot down over Slovakia in June 1944. Airmen were told that in the event of a crash, they should try to get to Slovakia, as the population was sympathetic to Americans. Slovaks were likely willing to help, as opposed to the inhabitants of other countries where airmen were often killed with pitchforks and axes.
Keď nám doviezli do Grinavy amerických letcov ako zajacov, mal som 11 rokov. No tak chlapci, viete, každý bol zvedavý, čo sú to za ľudí. No a tak čím ďalej, tým viacej sme sa približovali k bráne a k plotu a tak poznali sme dobre ich denný režim.
Grinava was an army camp. We had a couple of guards. They didn't have guns. They had bayonets. We played volleyball outside the fence.
Pravidelne každý deň okolo 9. hodiny pozerali na tých svojich kamarátov, ktorí sú v kabínkach lietadiel, ktoré nad nimi lietajú. Pokrikovali, gestikulovali, niektoré vyskakovali, nebolo ich veľa. Keď skončilo toto predstavenie, zobrala sa celá skupina Američanov s jedným vojakom a išli na morské oko.
Some of the men got pretty close to some of the gals there, and we got in the cornfield with them. And we had a great time. People say, well, why didn't you escape? Who would want to leave there? You know, it was marvelous.
To je nábojnica. A je americká, áno. Je to 44. rok. Jak to letadlo horelo, tak tá nábojnica explodovala. Je to vidieť, že proste je roztrhnutá. Takže prešla to katastrofou.
To musela byť pekná kríza pre nich. Panika na palube, keď horí lietadlo a vlastne už im išiel len jeden motor.
My sme byli 4 sestry tady, sme pásli tie husy. No a včeli vyletelo letadlo odnekát, hrozne zavíjalo. Nížej kúšček, len to letadlo takto robil, takto. A vyletel z neho človek a jak spadajú he na tých rolách, takto. No, oni ho trepali, ale to tam byl zabitý na mieste. Môj tatko na koňoch vezli a nemieli ho dedať, tak ho dali do hasičskej zbrojnice na zem. Ešte jakási kontrola musela prísť, až potom ho mohli pochovať. Starí rodičia byli v Americe a viedeli, že ten človek je z Ameriky, z oného, tak oni cítili s ním. Cítili s ním, že tá rodina sa niekedy bude za ním hlásiť. A my by sme sa špatne cítili, keby sme nechali ho na pospas zvírencom nejakým, lebo nepomohli mu.
Pilot to Pro, we're coming up on the bombing run in 10 seconds.
We go up and hit Black Hammer, which is one of the hardest charges, oil refineries. I'm sitting up there looking directly at it, 25,000 feet down there. And all of a sudden, wham, everything's just shaking apart. Look out, right motor is on fire. The flames all go right past my bow turret with the smoke. And that's when it said, prepare to bail out.
Toto sú plechy od vojny v 44. čo tu to americké lietalo, bombardér B-17. My sme ako chasni tu boli. Jako letelo, vrchov Čeky Svrči nám lámalo na šírku krídel. A asi takých 10 metrí boli zlámané tí vrchov Čeky, aj možná 20. A potom už lomilo celé Svrčiny. A celé Svrčiny, my sme tu prišli, pod ním boli tí Svrčiny takto zhodzené. Motory odletené, tri motory boli pred ním asi 5 metrí, dva spolu, tretí nižšie a jeden bol skúľaný toto dolu. Krídla boli celé len tak boli prirazené pri tom lietadle. Celé, ešte tam boli dobré plechy, tam sa dobré plechy brali z neho. Či horolo ve vzduchu, to nemôžem potvrdiť, to môže potvrdiť Silas. Len toľo otec povedal, že mu povedal, zasiahle dva motory. Na horách partizáni a tu vedení boli Nemci ubytovaní. Oni vedeli, že sa tu desi skrýva ten Silas. To musela byť vôľa Božia, že k nám prišiel a si zachránil život. Bolo to ten deň. A z hory prišli Nemci a to ozbrojení všetko. My sme mali psa, on už ich zastavil tuto na dvore. Silas sedel tuto na tej lavice, aj my sme tu boli všetcia. Pána, len čo vybehnú cichohrdinsko dom tam a už sa Nemci hrnuli do dverí. Len partizán, partizán.
Germans came looking for me, Rizak's family, in the hayloft. And I was right in the corner, curled up just as small as I can get. It was laying on planks. You could see through it. If I had urinated or anything, that would have been a dead giveaway.
Oni tam cez tých pári dolu, ako aj chodili donútra. Najprv pušky držali v rukách, ale keď sa už otec s nimi dal do debaty, vtedy už tí pušky všetko zložili, opreli o ten schod. Možná nebudem s nimi sa dohovoriť, to tak je zle. Potom máme povedávať napražila vajca, sme mali kúry, škvarenice so škvarkýma, tí šesti sa najedli. A keď mali ísť preč, zebral jeden ten Nemec tú pušku s tým bodákom, vyšiel na ten poval a odsila sa bol asi 2 metre. A pena, nech partizán. Keby boli naši, tak my nežijeme, aj tento dom nestojí, vypália všetko.
They found it, turn around. And boy, my heart, I knew they was going to hear me up there. My heart would give me away the sound of it, but it didn't. They got out. We watched them go down on the road. They went down, they all went down towards town. I was saying, yabamsy, you know what that is? Yabamsy. And he called them every name that he could think of. Come back, you haven't got your job done. You lousy, that's the reason you're losing the war. You're bad soldiers. Come on up here, you can find them. I still got them.
Tu bol sila zukrytý, tu v tom sene. Zíme sa, musím tu zdržovať, nemohol sa izbe moc zdržovať. Perinu mal a mám tam aj kýbel na toaletu a mám kámu, to musela vynášať.
Hannah, she was the most tender, worried with all of us. She wanted to make sure that I, as her adopted son, got through safely. So I always called her my angel. They call me a hero, and I keep telling them, the Slovaks were the heroes. They had nothing. The Germans took what they didn't have and went even deeper. And they would shoot any of them just for shooting pleasure.
To bolo pod skrytom. Ja ani deti som sa nepriznal nikomu, že tu je u nás. Tak bratcovia boli. Otec povedal, keď nám budú aj peniaze dávať, nevideli ste nič a nikoho nevideli.
Without them willing to risk their lives, the lives of their children, the family, being hanged, being shot, or just being tortured to death. How many of us would do this for a total stranger?
On the bomb run, I always took my helmet off, because when I go over the bomb site, the helmet come down like this, and I push it up, go boom, and take that damn thing off. We were on the bomb run, and for some reason, I'll never know, I reached back and I put my helmet on. And when I did, boom, hit piece of flak. Actually, it should have gone right through my head. And the gasoline was running, the stream running out. Opened the bomb bay doors, and the gasoline just poured out. They said, if anybody had lit a cigarette in that airplane, I just bailed out, and I started to walk. There was a hole there. Somebody must have dropped a bomb. Put my gun up on the side, and man, I fell sound asleep. I'm sleeping, and all of a sudden I hear, whoosh, whoosh. Hear the farmers coming. At about that time, I saw them, they saw me, I grabbed my gun, and I pointed at them, and they're going, no, 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 no. And the one guy said, stay here, and we'll come and get you tonight. My knees were all swollen up, I could hardly walk. They took me to the hospital there, and
when the Slovak uprising against fascism broke out in August 1944, the American airmen escaped from the POW camp in Grinova. Many of them succeeded in reaching liberated territory controlled by the uprising army, with the help of partisans and resistance fighters. But unfortunately, not all of them made it.
When we got to the edge of Trnava, we're crossing the bridge, the lights come on, and they're waiting for us, the Slovaks, the bad Slovaks. So they take us to the local jail, and the next day, and we went to Vienna, to the Hotel Metropole, which was a Gestapo headquarters. And then they'd take me downstairs and they'd beat the shit out of me. They didn't beat me every day, but whenever they came at night, take me down to question me, and they would beat me. So, and that went on and on and on. That was a bad time. So I was there for now well over a month, month and a half. Airplanes had come overhead, American B-24s, way up in the sky. They were bombing Vienna, but they didn't drop on us. But they would drop these delayed bombs and the daylight raid, but at night the bombs would go off, you know. Scare the Jesus out of you. I was scared stiff all the time.
A piece of the shrapnel came right up through the co-pilot's seat and just tore him all apart. When the pilot told us to bail out, he said he couldn't see much of anything because of the things that flew out of the co-pilot, the skin and bones or whatever was on the windshield. I think the Germans had some planes out looking for me the first day or two. But after that, I didn't hear any more planes. There was only me in the mountains. So I drank water out of the streams and I ate blackberries. I just walked and walked until I could find civilization.
American bombers landed at the Three Oaks airstrip in September 1944. They were transporting arms for the uprising army, along with Office for Strategic Services intelligence agents led by Lieutenant James Holt Green. Agents of Slovak origin who wanted to fight the fascists and help the resistance were with them. The aim of the mission was to evacuate the downed airmen to Italy and obtain information about German military operations.
The place that they took me to, there were 28 other escaped POWs and like me, escapees or evadees, and it got us all together. The airplane that I was supposed to go on taxied too far down the airfield and he got in a swamp. Everybody got on there, everybody got on the wings and pushed, you know. We got him out. Away we went, back to Italy.
I thought, here we are. Now we're going to go back to Italy. The next mission, they're going to send a plane on. But it rained the next day, so they didn't come. Then they told us, I think the man that ran the mission said, we have to get out of there because the Germans are getting close to Banska Bystrica and we will all be captured. if we don't get out.
When the Germans overran the town, Banská Bystrica, and President Tiso publicly declared his allegiance to Nazi Germany, the OSS intelligence group and the airmen fled into the mountains to escape special German units that were hunting down the resistance and the Americans. Slovak interpreter and guide Maria Golovikova joined the fleeing Americans. She took great risk, bringing food to the Americans through German patrols from occupied settlements to help keep them alive.
I just joined the 14 Americans that were with this OSS outfit, and we all went up in the mountains along with the village people. It was the worst weather I think I was ever in. The snow was clear up above our knees up there in the mountains, Tatra Mountains. The Slovaks from the town, they were not in good health, and when they would slouch down to rest, they never got up. And when we saw that, we said, hey, that's probably what's going to happen to us. So if we don't get out of here, we talked to the man that was at the head of the mission. When he found out we were going to leave the group, he said when we got back to the States, we would be in big trouble because we went against his orders. His orders were, don't leave. And we said, if we stay with you, we're probably going to die.
Eventually, the airmen preferred captivity to freezing to death in the mountains. And at the base of the Dumbier, they were ambushed by the Germans. After severe beatings, they were shipped off to POW camps. The OSS group retreated higher and deeper into the mountains, sleeping outside in the cold and suffering from frostbite and on the verge of collapse, they eventually took shelter at the mountain lodge Podhomoku. However, a special German Abwehr unit was on their tail, and aided by a Slovak informer, the majority of the mission was captured. Maria Golovikova and two Americans managed to escape. While Lieutenant Green's OSS group fought for their survival in the mountains, other members, Daniel Pavlicich and Captain Edward Baranski, descended from the mountains of Polana and found shelter with the family of Josef Virto in the village of Detva Piešt.
Oni prišli k nám len tak, že si oddychnul, umil sa, no a potom poprosil kapitán starého otca, či by nemohli ich za čas ubytovať. No a teraz zostala dilema, že čo s nimi, lebo to bolo, viete, báli sa naši tiež, že chodili Nemci všade už tu okolo. Hlavný bol u nás starý otec. No oni sa tak dohodli s kapitánom, že keď by ich náhodou chytili, že musia hovoriť, že nevedia, kto sú, že si oni mysleli, že sú Nemci a to musia tvrdiť, aj keby čo bolo. Kapitán, on mal takú záľubu, so mnou sa vždy hrával. Si stál, rozkročil si nohy a ja som mu okolo nôh sa hrala. Potom ma chytil na dlaň a takto popodpovalo, že ako lietadlo lieta. On mal takého syna o 2 mesiace mladšieho, nechal doma, dcerku nahal doma. Ja som mu to tak kompenzovala. Otec doniesol mapu a pozerali, že kde je front. Keď sa to stalo. Pod každým oknom bol Nemec s automatom aj pri každých dverách. Všetkých postavili k múru a ja ako dieťa som behala tam pomedzi nich, tak moja mama sa zavše za mnou otočila a chytila ma za ruku a videla, že Baranský dačo chce povedať. Keď ich už raportovali, tak mama schytila taký uterák a dala mu na krk. A on povedal, že píšte mojej žene. Zobrali aj mojich starých rodičov obidvoch, aj mojho otca na gestapo dozvolená. Moja mama tá pozháňala, čo mohla tam, čo boli aj predsedovia Hlinkových strán a toto, viete, kaďakých svedkov. Na základe toho sa podarilo ako starých rodičov zachrániť. No bola to zrada. Bola to zrada. Keby to nie, tak by sa boli zachránili. No. A naši si to vždy vyčítali, že im nezachránili životy.
Captain Baranský and Daniel Pavlitich were taken to the Mauthausen concentration camp where they were reunited with Green and his OSS agents. After a series of brutal interrogations and cold-blooded torture, the SS then ordered them to undress and enter a room one by one for photographs and a medical exam. They were individually stood against the wall and shot in the back of the head. Their bodies were then burned in the crematorium, and their ashes were added to a huge pile of innocent victims from all over Europe.
We were on our 12th mission to Vienna, Austria. Our greatest enemy was German anti-aircraft, flak. It was just a great fear, I guess, maybe kind of like a tornado coming, and you can't do anything except just grip and hold on, you know, and maybe say a prayer.
My oxygen tube was cut by flak, so that I would pass out unless I took the tube after 2 or 3 minutes, held my hand over the hole and go with pure oxygen, and probably that saved my life because it kept me from being panicked.
When I landed in the top of a little ridge there, so I followed the track northward, and a few minutes later, I saw the forester. And of course, he was beckoning to me to come to him. And I thought, well, he looks like a little guy. I might have been 3 or 4 inches taller than he was. And I said, I can probably handle him if he tried to capture me and turn me into the Germans. Thought that in my mind, you know. When I got to him, he was so gracious, so friendly. All my fears were gone. Felt like I'd had a bad dream and it was over.
So I was very glad when I saw little boys, schoolboys, and I thought perhaps they had been sent to find me and to lead me to the partisans. But when we saw a German patrol, they said, hey, here he is. And they drove me to Tristan. There were 3 of my crew already there. I made 4. A German guard took us to Vienna and then to interrogation center in Oberursel.
Chystali drevo. A počujeme nejaký zvuk letadla, prichádzali k nám A jedno letadlo asi bolo zasiahnuté, lebo také niečo. Stromy popadané, odrezané. Tak, jak to kosil, tí stromy kosil. A tu padlo na tomto mieste, jak sme tu teraz.
Keď som ja sem prišiel, už tu boli nejakí ľudia. A za chvíľočku potom prišli nemeckí vojaci. Odhánali nás odtiaľto. Ale my ako chalani, no tak zvedaví, išli sme do blízkosti a keď sme sa dostali, keď tí vojaci boli trošičku tak, že nás nepozorovali, my sme sa predsa len tam šmykli a podarilo sa nám nejaký ten náboj proste si uchmatnúť pre seba.
Co bych lutoval tých ľudí? Čo som vám bude, chlapci? Mladí chlapci, to bolo 18 ročí, 20 ročí, mladí chlapci. A tu tej zeme padnú, čo je to?
Predsa len sadnú do takého stroja, ísť také kilometre, to si uvedomoval, toľké kilometre. A riskovať svoj mladý život sa mi zdalo také dosť kruté. To bola odvaha týchto mladých mužov. Až riskovali zbytočne svoje mladé životy.
I was in a bomb bay and one of the gunners called up and says, number two engine's on fire. We tried to get the pilot out of the seat, even the co-pilot, Sullivan, couldn't get him out.
I was the last person in the back end of the aircraft before bailing out. I should have taken time to call the pilot and tell him the back end is all clear. But I didn't do it. I just left and then the pilot sent the co-pilot to the back to check and see whether the back of the aircraft was empty. And the pilot had no chance of getting out because the wing started breaking off and we had no flying ability anymore. I still look back and I said, I should have, I could have, but I didn't. All over with and too late.
Doviedli potom tých dvoch chalanov k nám a tak hovorili, že teda budú u nás. Ten Lorenc, ten rozumel slovenský, keď mal tú babku Češku. Sprvu už tak to bolo taký cudzí, no, lebo oni sa báli, nevedeli, kde sú a už, že sme sa potom už tak, jak sa hovorí, že zočili, že sme sa skamarádili, no tak oni už potom nás učili aj dobré ráno, aj všetko teda tak povedať, aj čítať som vedela. A však už asi, ja by som to 1, 2, 3, 7, 8, 9, 10. No však to ma učili, čo sa som vedela, no.
Ja si pamätám, keď havarovalo to lietadlo, mama doviezla do Lamaného Slivena. Povedala, nesmíš nikomu nič povedať a žiadne kamarátky domu. A to bolo jasné heslo. On žil u nás v byte. No počúval rádio, rád jedol a normálne žil, ako náš.
I wonder how many Americans would do that if they were at war and have someone land in your yard with a parachute, you know, and you take them in and treat them like a brother.
In the other countries, we were told that people, peasants, might be carrying pitchforks, axes or whatever, and they're going to go ahead and just butcher you up. And these just hugged me, so I told me, I am with friends, not enemies.
Ten Lorenz, on mal úžasný strach, on sa úplne trásil a on keď aj niekto prišiel, on hneď si išiel prisadnúť k tému človekovu a hneď už len išiel načúvať, pravda, umýkal sa. Lebo k nám chodili ľudia, dejaké zvesty chodili, pravda povedať, kde sú Nemci, alebo ako ustupujú, kde sú partizáni a čo je. On sa úplne chvel. No, bodaj by sa nechvel.
That feeling was always there that it could be your turn. And you don't know what that turn might be. Getting killed, getting captured, or anything in between.
Tak sme sa báli, keď nám aj ľudia, pravda, keď chodievali k nám a hovorili, že teda by si ich dali naši preč, že keď tu prídu Nemci, že teda nás vystrieľajú a že vystrieľajú pol dediny. Ja si myslím, že keď ich schovávali, tak ich schovávali z lásky, aby im zachránili život. A keď boli moji rodičia v Amerike, že keď oni tam boli toľko, takže im tú lásku, že zase tým Amerikánom, že sa zvrátili. Ja si to tak myslím, že to za peniaze nerobím, ale to robím z lásky a že komu si ich dobre som urobila, že ma dosi bude po dobre spomínať.
The Bakars had to be a meeting point or something. And then when we were there, then they start more by crew members were coming that the Slovaks found. And we all went there and got a little sleevo. I helped the pond make sleevo. I know all about a still, and I know about cranking it. Oh yeah, top man in making the booze.
Stefan Bockhart had the boy, the son. I guess he was about 2 years older than I was. I was 19, he was probably 21. The girls, Betka and Anna, one of them was pretty and one of them wasn't. Betka was kind of cute.
Me and Anichka had a thing going. Oh yeah. Old Pawnee had the wedding all made out already. I says, what do you mean talk about weddings, eh? Talk about no wedding, I gotta go home. You couldn't think about falling in love or nothing. You don't know if you're going to end up sitting on a hand grenade or a bayonet of a gun or something. Nah. And then you were always worried you didn't want to get captured because what's going to happen to the people that is keeping you? All them farmers out there that helped us, they put their life on the table to help us. And we didn't do nothing for them.
I think they were patriots, Slovak patriots, who were risking their lives, really, by hiding an enemy flyer there. Certainly were. In many cases, earlier in the year, there were reports of many Slovaks being shot, trying to help partisans and down American or Allied flyers. And still, they didn't care. They thought it was their duty.
From the Bakars, we went to the partisans' camp. John Repta was in charge there. The Germans were more scared of him than he was of the Germans. They're trying to teach us in one day how to fight with a machine gun.
That was a Gulamet, is that right? Automatic rifle. But he got us out in the field and we practiced running and getting down and not shooting, but acting like we were going to shoot. Put us through maneuvers, so to speak. We thought, what is this? We're going to be partisans?
John Zabrowski, he was a co-pilot from other crew, and he talked to Mr. Repton. This isn't our line of business. We don't know nothing about ground fighting. Says we want to get back to Italy so we can go flying again and drop some more bomb.
I never thought that we might get killed, but Zabrowski did. And he got kind of fearful. He told me, he said, Gene, if the Germans take this place, they'll shoot us on sight. They found out we're Americans in civilian clothes, with the partisans and armed, they'll shoot us without even thinking twice.
Repta had a feeling that something was going to be happening. So he sent us all away.
Then the next day we heard shooting and everything going on. The Germans found the compound of the partisans. They had a battle out there. They wiped out the compound. If we would have been there, that would have been the end for us.
Na Vianoce, na štedrý večer, všetci prišli k nám a spievalo sa. Oni spievali po anglicky, jingle bell a neviem teda dále. A my zas naše pesničky sme ze sestrou aj s rodičmi spievali.
My family didn't know where I was alive or dead. I was just missing in action. Particularly on Christmas Eve, I started thinking about my family, and I got so sad I wanted to go outside, and I went out beside Bockhart's house to a little bare tree with all the limbs off. Maybe it was a little plum tree. Slivo tree, strum, what's tree, strum, whatever. And I actually prayed that they might know or have a feeling somehow that I was alive and not grieve, because here I was so thoroughly taken care of and couldn't let anybody know. I actually wept out there in the snow by myself.
Mamička tá cítili s nimi, že nejsú doma, pravda, a že tiež tí matky jej ich tak nad nimi ako smutia, ako aj oni, mamička. Tak ako jej ich synovia, keby boli.
We got to Wild Alley, we thought we should make an attempt to break out and go to the Russian front. Most ridiculous idea you can think of. Miss Bockhart begged us not to go with tears in her eyes. Somehow she was able to communicate with us. She couldn't speak hardly any English about how dangerous it was, and we didn't need to do that. And actually, we didn't.
Keď už teda povedali, že odchádzajú, ďakovali velice, no a mamičke to bolo ľúto. To ich trápilo, že zle pochodia, že aby radšej vydržali, nož a oni nevydržali už, utekali ako na čierno a tak aj zle dopadli.
Germans, they sent out a scouting party. So the scouting party come over, and that's how they caught us. But they didn't catch us in the house. And we were running, trying to get away from them, and they started shooting at us. And I looked, turned around, and they, one at a time, they were falling on the ground. I figured I better fall down too.
Solomon was right behind me. He said, "Speak Slovak, Gene. Don't let them know we're American." I said, "We're American flyers. Don't shoot." Then the guy started hailing, screaming, "Hans, off! Hans, off!" And I was scared to death, naturally. When they put us in the prison in Sunica, the next morning we were threatened pretty bad about being shot. Sully had already been interrogated, who gave us the clothes, who had been trying to feed us. No plane had gone down recently. It'd been 3.5 months since the plane went down right in that area. You know, and where have you been? Who's hiding you? We don't know what to do with you except shoot you. The war was almost over, wasn't it? And we're probably lucky that it was that late. Because even the SS and Gestapo had softened their technique or their whatever torturing methods they all used so long.
Čo sa týka Sullivana, mama mu dala adresu. Dal si ju do hodiniek. A keď ho zobrali, Nemci, my sme nevedeli, či tú adresu má v tých hodinkách, či si ju vyložil. So strachom sa čakalo, že kedy dôjdu zasa Nemci pre nás, lebo majú adresu jedného amerického pilota. Bola to nezodpovednosť nielen voči sebe, ale nezodpovednosť voči tým, ktorí ich pol roka ukrývali.
This is a piece picked up where my airplane crashed. We picked it up in 1989 in Skuchanka near Dobra Voda when Jan Mabinchak helped me and my three children find the place where where the crash took place. That shook me up a little, seeing those pieces. I mean, that's when I say that was really the end of the war for me.
We've lived in the best generation, really. Even though we went to war. Maybe we learned a lot going to war, I don't know. I don't go to many reunions because I don't know anybody there. My whole family in the Army is gone. All of my buddies that I was with in the airplane are gone.
I think there's only two of us, Baumgarten and me. This year we lost track of Sullivan, our co-pilot. And then getting older and everything's going to shot. So it's all going downhill now. Oh, I can sit in the corner sometime and think about the good old days. And I think about a lot about Slovakia. I never forgot them, still haven't. That's a chapter in my life will always be there.
Tí americkí leci tiež si to predstavovali inak. hrdinovia boli z ich pohľadu, veď išli dobrovoľne. A u nás boli tí, ktorí dobrovoľne zasa ich zachraňovali. Takže hrdinstvo. To je také hrdinstvo, ktoré by som v živote nechcela, aby sa zopakovalo.
After the war, American families found it difficult to deal with the loss of their loved ones. So they traveled to Slovakia to find closure and to learn about how their lives ended. Young amateur historians, together with local inhabitants, located the crash sites and put up symbolic crosses bearing the names of the fallen airmen in respect to their memories. For many people, these Americans are unsung heroes, but they simply wanted to honor the memory of these airmen who not only fought for their country, but for the liberation of all Europe, including Slovakia. After many years, the airmen who survived returned to Slovakia to show their gratitude to the people who saved them. In a sense, their return to Slovakia was a rebirth.